hopefully you had a good coffee break, and please switch off your mobile phones. You know, modern vehicles have this possibility. And therefore, now it's for second panel, distinguished one, on another aspect of about high debts, about monetary policy, whether that's helpful. So, Nils, please, go ahead.
Thank you very much, Joris. So my name is Nils Bühnemann. I'm very honored to be entrusted with the task of moderating this second panel. Thanks to Latvijas Banka to invite me to do that. My background is that of partly a press officer in the European Central Bank for 15 years, but 1 year ago I left the ECB in order to re-establish a career as a journalist, which I was before. So that's basically where I come from. And unlike some of the previous speakers, I have been in Riga many times. I have been involved in the communication work concerning the introduction of the euro into this country, and I have made several other projects for together with the Latvijas Banka. So I'm very pleased to be back, and I'm very thankful for the first panel that they have set the stage for this discussion, which will focus more on policy implications of debt, on the establishment of growth. Quite rightly so, because we do have policymakers on the panel here. I will introduce you to the panelists in a moment. But first, maybe I'll just say a few words on how I would like to frame this discussion. Given that we have policymakers here, I think we should talk a little bit about the issue of, let's say, whether we have still independent central banks that can navigate in a situation with high debt, and where actually a lot of the debt is ending up on the balance sheet of the central bank. There are some concerns that this might impede the independence of the central banks, that they have this debt on their balance sheet. Some people call it the lack of monetary dominance, monetary dominance being the ability for the central bank to do what it needs to do in order to secure the fulfillment of its tasks. And as a contrast to that, people speak about financial repression in this environment where we have a lot of debt but very low interest rates. So that means, in the end effect, the savers are paying the bill for having all this debt, because we need to keep interest rates low in order not to jeopardize financial stability. So these are some of the problems that we can talk about. And I would actually like to engage with the audience a little bit, also like John did in the first session. And I would like to just put you in the place of the central bank. So you have a job to do. You need to keep inflation low. But at the same time, you know that there is this huge accumulated debt out there. We have heard the numbers in the first panel. Let's say debt to GDP ratios of 100% and above is no longer an exception. It's quite common to have that. And the question I would like you to think about now and answer is, if you were the central bank and you would see inflation slowly but steadily going up, I'm quite convinced it will happen at some stage. We don't see it right now. But think about this happening and being aware that there is a huge stock of debt out there. Would you, as a central bank, hesitate in raising interest rates where you would see the necessity to do that to rein in inflation, but you would be worried about what would happen to the servicing of all this debt? So please raise your hand if you, as a central bank, would be hesitant to raise interest rates in a high debt environment. Well, so I conclude that the rest of you would be tough and you would go on and raise the interest rates. That's a very interesting proposition that maybe we can have the panelists commenting on later on. And of course, the panelists are also invited to comment on what the first panel provided of information. I should also again repeat, we had a lot of Twitter activity this morning, and I hope this will continue. I will try to follow it on my tablet here and take the questions from the tweeters. But I would also be very grateful if from time to time there would be someone in the audience who would raise a hand and ask a question so that we get some, let's say, human activity also on the from the floor. That would be very nice, and I will certainly ask you to do that. So let me just proceed with introducing you to the panelists that we have here. I will take them in alphabetical order, and obviously in your folders you have all the biographical details, so I will not repeat that, but I will just maybe add a few features as I experience and as I have followed the panelists over time. First, on my left-hand side, Ivan Miklos, Member of Parliament in the Slovak Republic, former finance minister, but also an educated economist, and I would say a political economist. What I would add to that is that I see Ivan as a very bold reformer. He's prominent to be that. And I would put him in the school of people like Leszek Balcerowicz, Václav Klaus, and actually I asked you before whether you would mind being put in that school of thought, and since you didn't mind it, I think I will go ahead and say you are one of the prominent members of this club of bold reformers. And maybe, let's say, there will be other categories that you could put. Some people might call you neoliberal. That's something that is not always meant in a nice way, but that's the fact of life, that you sometimes are being put into various categories. But I would say in general you have a conservative view on fiscal policy, and it will be interesting to see what your opinions are in the interrelationship between fiscal policy and monetary policy, which is not your field of experience, but as we all know, there is a close relationship between the two. Then, left of Ivan, we have Peter Prat, who is a member of the executive board of the European Central Bank since 2010.
11.
Okay. I've been working with you so many years there. So. Anyway, Peter is, before joining the ECB, he had a distinguished career both in commercial banking and in central banking, serving the Central Bank of Belgium, which in parentheses is one of the countries that used to have the highest debt ratio. Now it's been overtaken quite substantially by some others, but it maybe belongs to the baggage of Peter that you have lived in this country. I don't blame you for it, but it's a fact that you have experience from this country which had historically a high debt level and is now fighting its way back to reducing it, quite successfully so, I have to say. And Peter also has experience as a lecturer in universities, so that goes to speak for his communication abilities. And then I would say for myself, having worked at the ECB, regardless of age, and think I'm not going to reveal Peter's age, but for me, he and the other people who joined the ECB's executive board around that time, they are for me the young ECB executive board, as compared to the previous members who maybe had a more traditional view. And of course, Peter is an architect, one of the architects behind the non-standard measures that the ECB has launched over the past few years to fight the crisis. Next on the further to the left of Peter is, of course, someone you all know, Ilmar Šimšević, governor of the Latvijas Banka. No need to introduce Ilmar specifically here in this audience, but I would just say that I'm impressed, again, in terms of age, no discrimination here, but Ilmar is the longest serving governor in the European Union of any national central bank, despite his relatively young age, which is quite impressive, I have to say. And I think on the ECB's governing council, you are not the longest serving, but you are close. I think only Vítor Constanciu has been serving on the governing council longer than you have. So that's That's not the General Council, I should say, because the Governing Council is, of course, something you joined only a couple of years ago. But the General Council of the ECB, there you are the second longest-serving member, despite this country having joined the European Union only in 2004. So also quite impressive. And I have also to add that Ilmaz, again this morning, demonstrated that you have very clear views and that you do belong to those in the Governing Council of the ECB who are critical or skeptical of some of the measures that have been taken. We can come back to that as we go along. And then the fourth member of the panel is Tuomas Saarenheimo from Finland. Also with a central banking background, but now serving as a permanent undersecretary of the finance ministry. So that means Tuomas is the guy who sits next to the minister when he goes to international meetings. And Tuomas also has a past in the IMF as executive director for the Nordic-Baltic constituency, to which obviously also Latvia belongs. And I would say the reputation that Tuomas has, when you ask people about him, is like all Finns, he's a no-nonsense guy, so we can expect some clear statements from him, even though, of course, it's a non-political position you are in. That's something that we need to be aware of. Maybe unlike the three others, you are more like a civil servant. So. With this, I would proceed to give the panelists the opportunity to say something about the topic, but based on a question that I would like to ask each of them. So I will start with you, Ivan, if you don't mind. I would say, given now that we have this huge debt load that has ended up on the balance sheet of the central bank, so quantitative easing, QE, how would you say that influences the policy making in other policy areas, like, for example, fiscal policies and structural policies, which we also should discuss? Would you say that if there would not be QE, would, for example, in your country, the fiscal policy be different? Would there be a different approach to that?
Thank you. Thank you, Niels. Thank you for inviting me to this conference. Last time and only one I was here in Riga, it was almost 20 years ago, and I have to say that I see that Latvia did great progress and great development. Let me congratulate you to this. And Latvia is among the most successful transition countries with other Baltic countries, Poland and Slovakia, which means is very important also if we are speaking about situation in the Western Europe, situation in the necessary structural reforms and fiscal consolidation. I also admire Latvian crisis management during 2008 and 2009. And usually I'm using the two short quotations. First one is from Paul Krugman, whom I disagree with his opinions, who said in 2008 that Latvia is next Argentina. And next one is from Mario Draghi, who said in 2013 that Latvia is model for Europe. This illustrates really the big achievement which was done during this crisis management. And I'm convinced that Latvian experience and experience from other transition countries are useful also for countries like Greece. Briefly, to answer the question, what is the effect of quantitative easing for fiscal and structural policy, I think is negative. I understand why it was launched, but I think that predominantly it is negative. And finally, I agree with what Ilmar said in his introductory speech about this effect. Let me illustrate this by something. My another favorite quotation is from Thomas Sowell, who is American economist and writer. He said, "The first lesson of economics is scarcity. There are not enough sources to satisfy all needs. And the first lesson of politics is to ignore the first lesson of economics." And then, as a result, we have growing indebtedness, living beyond the means, and all these problems which we are facing now. And if you are speaking about quantitative easing, I think quantitative easing doesn't have the effects which were expected, or at least not in such amount as it was expected, but it has another negative side effects which were maybe not expected at that time. We spoke at the first panel that there are three methods, three tools, how to reduce indebtedness: growth, inflation, and fiscal consolidation. We see that despite of quantitative easing, inflation is close to zero, almost no inflation. And of course, threat of deflation was one of the main reasons why quantitative easing was launched. But if you are speaking about growth, we have to speak about, which means inflation doesn't work in the current situation. Question is why. Growth, it doesn't work because growth is mostly preconditioned by structural reforms. There are not sufficient structural reforms. And fiscal consolidation is also insufficient. One of the reasons why growth and fiscal consolidation are not sufficient is quantitative easing. Quantitative easing is softening pressure for doing structural reforms, is softening pressure also for necessary fiscal consolidation. If there are almost zero or even minus, Slovakia, but also Latvia, Czech Republic, is now among 13 countries which can borrow in negative interest rates. Of course, then it is much more relaxed conditions for to do fiscal consolidation. What is, I think, the key importance is to recognize difference between solvency and liquidity. At the financial crisis in 2008-2009, it was necessary to have monetary expansive policy, and it was one of the lessons from the crisis in the 30s. To avoid freezing of the assets and then also collapse and bankruptcy of those subjects which are not insolvent but only illiquid. But the problem is that by prolonging of this policy longer than crisis years, we are then bailing out and we are saving not only those who were illiquid but also those who were insolvent. And this is the problem, that quantitative easing is reducing necessary pressure for doing structural reforms and for doing fiscal consolidation measures, who are only real tools for solving indebtedness and for increased competitiveness. Which means effect of quantitative easing is very controversial, at least, in my opinion, mostly negative. Also because quantitative easing has some effects which are very negative. First one, and maybe the most important, is that apart from this softening conditions for necessary reforms, that it is more tool for wealthy redistribution than for growth supporting. It is clear that quantitative easing is increasing income inequality, which then is one of the reasons for the political tensions, for the growing dissatisfaction, and one of the obstacles for doing necessary structural reforms. Another problem is that quantitative easing is also policy of type of to beggar your neighbor. Because quantitative easing has one of the effect devaluation or depreciation of the currency, then increasing competitiveness not through structural reforms but through reducing the value of currency. And then of course it is pushing also other countries to do the same, to use this tool, because if not, then in the global competition, they are in the worst situation. Which means, let me conclude these introductory remarks that what is really important are macroeconomic stabilization, because it's not only about fiscal consolidation, but maybe fiscal consolidation is the most important among tools for macroeconomic stabilization, and structural reforms. And this is universal rule. This is true for southern European countries, this is true for Ukraine now, this is true for any country. Which means, if I may conclude by saying, what is the effect of quantitative easing for Slovakian fiscal and structural policy, I can say that it is negative because it is softening necessary pressure for doing reforms. Fortunately, Slovakia is in not such bad situation because we did really deep reforms before and we are still profiting from these reforms. But we see, and I can speak about this in details, but I don't want, we see that quantitative easing is softening also in Slovakia, in countries like Slovakia, this pressure for the policy, which will be much better, especially from mid and long-term perspective.
Okay, thanks, Ivan. I'm sure, Peter, that you would want to take issue with some of this, but maybe before you do that, I would like to also direct it in a bit different direction, namely by asking you, if you look at the situation that we are in with this very accommodative monetary policy, zero interest rates, and in a way the interest rate is supposed to be a price that has an allocation mechanism in it also. But there is good debt and there is bad debt. So how can you ensure that this allocation mechanism works to increase the stock of good debt, meaning productive investments, rather than the increasing the bad debt, meaning, let's say, speculation in real asset, in asset prices, or other, let's say, undesired effects of this policy?
Okay. Good morning, and I'm very pleased to be here, in spite of what I had to hear. very respectful colleagues here, and I always also thought what you were doing when you were Minister of Finance also followed the reform. So I take it without any animosity for what you said. I think it's wrong what you say. It's wrong what you say, damn wrong what you say. But still, I can accept the discussion with you. The first points, Niels, you made, and I just take that at the beginning. Do we still have independent central bank? My answer is very clear, yes. And what we hear very often is that central banks have too much power and not the opposite. And so I would like to just say that on that. My contract is very simple contract. Price stability in the medium term, and we define that. And we have the tools. And that's why we got the independence. Now, of course, there are unintended consequences, and we are very well aware of that, and we will discuss that a little bit later. But don't tell me that the politicians don't have the prime responsibility if the structural reforms are not. They may take excuses because of central banks and say, well, you know, with low interest rate conditions, the incentive to reform will be pushed further away. But they will take that responsibility. We take our responsibility is trying to reach this objective in the medium term, which is inflation, as defined in our contract, as the politicians have determined that contract that I've signed when I joined the central bank. I will take a case more specifically on the points you made about what we call the asset purchase program. We try in general to avoid QE, but the expression QE is an asset purchase program. I just wanted to say that when the point came in the Governing Council, there was unanimity that asset purchases is part of the toolbox of the central bank. There may be differences, and there are differences across among central bankers to say, is it useful to do now, should we do it later, how much, and all this. But it's part of the toolbox. That's my second quick comment. Now, on your question, good debt and bad debt. The first point we have to think is the allocation of savings in our societies. I'm talking global. I think, personally, we have a problem of misallocation of savings in many regions of the world. So this is my first point, misallocation of savings. And it's always, for me, a big question how the financial system, which is supposed to allocate resources efficiently, can go in that situation where there's huge misallocations. real estate would be, of course, one of the main candidates for misallocation of resources. That's the first one. The second one, if you think there is misallocation of resources, you have to see how is it financed, this misallocation of resources. Is it with equity or is it with debt? So the problem is not so much a misallocation which is, has been done by equity funding, which is a problem per se, but not as dramatic than if it's done by debt. And of course, if it's leveraged debt, short-term, foreign currency, then you get problems, of course. Think about the dot-com, very quickly, the dot-com. There was a misallocation, ICT, huge investment in cables, you know, in fiber optic, in internet companies and all that. There was a misallocation of resources, there was a correction, but it was relatively mild. I know that in these years, the central banks, especially the US, reacted very strongly, thinking that this wealth correction would lead to a recession. It was a very activist policy at that time. And finally, the impact of this misallocation of resources was relatively benign, because it was not leveraged, it was not bank-funded, it was basically bonds and equity, but the bonds were the big corporate bonds which could be treated, as was said previously, via the normal solvency or the workout procedures that you have, especially in the United States. So, of course, the problem we have now is that you have this big misallocation of resources with basically debt finance, bank finance, short-term, sometimes with foreign capital and sometimes in foreign currency. And that magnifies. So the next question, the first question is to see what is the legacy? How much, you know, bad assets have you in the asset side of many balance sheets? The second question is to see how do you get out of this? Yeah. And the problem is the quality of institutions you have, as was mentioned previously. Private, you say, our American colleagues say, we have good institutions for that. That's not true. In some countries like Italy, but many other countries, you had very bad mechanisms to deal with creditor-debtors problems on the private sector. That's what these countries try to address now. Think about Slovenia, think about Italy, think about Spain a few years ago. They addressed that very well. Think about Portugal, and there are many other candidates. Think about Cyprus. So these are, the quality of institutions was very poor at the start of the, and all what we say about the central bank reaction, is it liquidity, is it solvency? I can tell you, any debt problems, when your institutions dealing with creditor-debtors problems are very weak, they very quickly go into a solvency problem. Because you cannot coordinate a solution, a reasonable solution, orderly deleverage, as we say, between creditors and debtors. You cannot in the absence of institution. You get very quickly insolvency and sort of spill over on the whole economy, which is the situation we have. So the central bank intervene, you say, it's good because they have to address the liquidity crisis. But in the absence of good institutions, the liquidity crisis goes very much in insolvency crisis. So that's debatable, of course, how far has the ECB gone in that sort of context. Don't forget also that a lot of the bad assets that I mentioned have been funded by short-term money from other countries of the monetary union. The excess savings of the Germans went to some extent in Spain, for example, to finance a real estate boom. So when we have a sudden stop of the funding, then you have whole banking system at risk. It's not only idiosyncratic, where some banks are. So we can continue that. So the bad debt, good debt, will depend in the end of your assessment of the misallocation of resource. I give you one common story for the planet, I think. When you look at, and I finish with that, you look at growth expectations 5 years ahead, as they were in 2000. And then you roll over. You say 2001, 5 years ahead. 2002, 5 years ahead, etc., etc. What you see is that in 2000, in the Eurozone, it was 2.4, 2.5, something like this. 5 years ahead, the annual growth rate. And it went continuously down. So think about investment, which we made in 2000, with the expectation that growth would be 2.4. Exposed, it was 1 point something. That's where the problem really starts. And that's the recognition of a deeper problem, which is the slowdown of productivity that we have a little bit everywhere in the world, and especially in the Eurozone. And that's where you need your structural reforms. I fully agree with that. What you do to facilitate this transition, well, the central bank play an important role by easing the credit conditions. My point is that think about the central bank not having done what they did. Think about that alternative scenario. It's debatable, I agree. I would see deflation and probably depression. You say, of course, it weakens the incentive to reform, and I think that's part of a sound debate. I have no problem with that. But I think about the other case. I was in a debate with the BIS, and the BIS said even in the Great Depression, in the US, the central bank did use these sort of non-standard measures. Well, we know that also from history that that was a monetary policy mistake, and that's how the country went into depression at that time. So I think using the argument that even in the past these instruments have not been used, I think history of banking crisis has been terrible. Now, you as a politician, you should know that even central bank having its mandate and say, I'm just staying put, you know, I'm staying passive because that would weaken the incentive. And even if my inflation is too low, given my objective, I say I don't care. I want to put pressure on governments to make reforms. Think about that scenario. You know your colleagues in the Eurogroup, what would have happened in these years. Now, I agree with you, you cannot ignore all these arguments that you put. So it's always a balancing act in the end. But the responsibilities must be where they are. Okay.
So the moderator loves it when there are contrasting views, and that's already something we have already after the first two contributions here. Ilmas, there is misallocation of savings. That's also what Peter has argued. But then he says the counterfactuals would have been much worse if we had not embarked on QE and other non-standard measures. How do you see it with your, let's say, critical view, but you are still, let's say, part of the college that formulates this policy? How do you see the risks from continuing this very accommodating monetary policy for a very long period of time? Is there a time frame for which you can say it becomes really distortionary and dangerous with the negative side effects that Ivan also mentioned?
Well, I believe we're already having an interesting debate here, and it has been quite live already. Yes, I must agree with Peter that QE is definitely in the toolbox. But we have to also see what else is in toolbox. We have used the TLTRO, VELTRO, all instruments, which when I went to school...
So maybe for those who are not familiar with these very long-term refinancing operations...
I'm about to tell this. When I went to school, then I was taught that the longest money the central banks are providing is only 3 months, and that not more. And then we went to 1 year, and then we went to 3 years, now to 4 years, and now we're buying everything what moves. basically, I still support it, and Peter knows this, that we supported QE. Yeah, this goes without saying. But we told this that let's be serious about it, that we have a certain period of time that central banks cannot substitute the role of government. Central banks cannot correct the macro imbalances, which has to be done by the politicians. So basically, we injected the money for some period of time. We don't know for how long. And I think, as we see in the United States, it will take many decades to pull the money out of the system, and it will not be easy. But what is important that at the moment we're doing this, and we're doing solidarily, because you asked at the beginning whether Latvia needs this. Certainly, Latvia doesn't need it. We don't have even so many instruments. We have bought already all the papers in Latvia. We're now buying papers of other institutions. That the most important thing is that we have a very strong message to the Commission, to the respective parliaments, and that's what we're trying to encourage also the governing board, the president, to do more to educate the politicians, to bring them this message that we alone cannot do this. And we could go on for a couple more years, but this is very precious time. And we have to ask ourselves, when we had this long-term money, and banks are not borrowing because there's a super, super liquid market. And banks are sitting with that liquidity and they don't know what to do with that. And the question is, has anybody organized the big panel why the banks are not lending to the real sector? And we have done this homework. And the answer is very simple. In a highly indebted environment, when they clearly know the next move is going to be the increase of the taxes and deteriorating the investment environment, why should I lend to this guy or to this project if in 2-3 years I will be bust? As simple as that.
So that's, again, an indication of there is a limit to how far you can go with these instruments, obviously. But Thomas, if we want to explore more, like the effectiveness of these policies, we should also consider maybe the fact that some countries are hit by exogenous shocks, by asymmetric shocks. That was an issue already before we introduced the euro. Does it really make sense to have a monetary union? And now that we are in the monetary union, the monetary policy cannot, as we heard, solve all problems. In particular, when a country is hit by an asymmetric shock, there is a limit to the effectiveness of these policies. And in fact, the country that is your home country has been in recession for, I think, 3 years now, despite this very accommodative monetary policy. So maybe you can clear us up on how you see the effectiveness of monetary policy for a country that is hit by an asymmetric shock, and how can we deal with this problem that it doesn't work and that you need other policy measures.
Thank you. First, thank you for inviting me. So I'm happy to be here. This is very interesting. I'll tackle your question first. Is this working?
Yes, intermittently at least.
Tackle your question first, and then I'll get back to this interesting debate that is going on. I mean, for Finland, using the analogy used in the previous panel, the QE and loose monetary policy is aspirin, and the real illness is elsewhere. It's helping, it's making us feel better, but the issues that we are dealing with are structural and cannot be fixed by monetary policy. I can't see any really serious side effects of loose monetary policy emerging in Finland either. And also the effect of the aspirin is quite limited because we never had a monetary problem to start with. I mean, Finnish banks are in fine shape. They are providing funding to the private sector at reasonable interest rates at very low margins. So in the end, we are not the ones who benefit from the unconventional measures to a great extent, but it's not really causing any problems either. Meanwhile, we are solving our structural problems in the manner that structural problems are usually solved, slowly, takes time, and QE provides a little bit of a help there. But if I may come back to this broader issue here, as a previous central banker, I remember these discussions from times before 2013, which was the year when I went to the dark side, basically to the ministry side. QE was not there yet, but it was in the debates. My view here is that monetary policy, I mean, oversimplifying quite a bit, but monetary policy is essentially trying to chase an unobserved measure called the equilibrium interest rate. If you hit that, then you stabilize inflation. If you don't, you get into trouble and then you have to adjust interest rates. And I think there are several reasons that point to the direction of the equilibrium interest rate staying low for quite a long time. With a consequence that monetary policy is likely to stay loose for quite a while, and these things I think covered a number of things. One is high debt levels that the previous panel discussed. The other is demographics, And I would add a third one, which has to do with commodities. I'll very briefly go through these three points. I mean, public debt levels, as was recognized this morning, for the last four decades, we've seen public debt levels going up and up and up. There's a certain ratchet effect. In good times, they stabilize. In bad times, they go up. But they never really go down. And I don't know what is the long-term safe level of public debt, but I do know, and I would think most of you agree, that this cannot go on forever. At some point, it needs to stop. And when it stops, even if we don't start to consolidate beyond just stabilizing debt level, even just stabilizing debt level means a negative fiscal impulse that is sizable. So we are going to face a negative fiscal impulse that will be going on for a while. Then there's the other side of the story. You have to remember that whenever you issue a public bond, someone buys it. It becomes usually a private asset. And I would claim that our private sector is to a large extent addicted to being provided what they consider or, somehow conceptualize as risk-free, liquid fixed income assets. We encourage that, partly due to banking regulation, through liquidity regulations, capital regulations, where we favor government bonds. But it's also inbuilt in the asset allocation practices of institutional investors. There is a very high demand for government bonds that has this sort of a depressing effect on equilibrium interest rates. Then the demographics issue. The ratio of retirees to active population is falling. It's falling permanently. It has very little to do with the baby boom, which is just a blip in the numbers. The big issues are increasing longevity and declining in birth rates. These both are permanent. They are global. So what we are going to see is a smaller active population and a much bigger retired population. Two ways of dealing with this. Either you raise taxes and use transfers to provide for the retirees, or then somehow there needs to be pre-funding, privately funded pension system, so that you can finance retirees from the proceeds of these private funds. So in order to, and since the governments are probably not in a position to do this through taxes and transfers, the latter one needs to be a big part of the solution. So we will need a bigger chunk of pension assets moving around the financial system globally and finding assets to invest in. So there's an additional factor of demand. And finally, the commodity thing, this is less important right now, but I wouldn't write it out. I think it's probably going to be important in the medium term again. Countries are pumping up limited resources, mainly in energy, like Norway, running out of oil to pump in 15 or 20 years. So what it is doing, it's doing what many other oil producers are doing. Building up, as they run down their natural resources, they are building up financial assets. Sovereign wealth funds, very big players in the global financial arena. Again, an additional factor in increasing demand for assets. So the dilemma that we are facing is that governments need to consolidate and curtail the supply of government bonds. And on the other side, there are several things that increase the demand for government bonds. So this will, in my opinion, result in a long period of low equilibrium real interest rate. A savings glut, if you wish, as using Ben Bernanke's language. My final point, how do we get out of this? Again, slowly, I think a big part of the solution is developing capital markets, encourage change in asset allocation of institutional investors, also through means of financial regulation, move towards what Peter referred to, the more equity-based, less debt-based financing overall, private and public. And that would then, in the end, hopefully launch investment, higher growth, and higher growth is, of course, what gets us out of this hole. Thank you. Sorry for being long. Yeah.
I know that Ivan wants to say something on one of the comments, but before we go to that, I would like to pick up this ball about equity, the existence of private debt as opposed to public debt, and ask Peter, is this something where the central bank has a role? Everybody knows that you are contemplating new instruments in the way of quantitative easing to be announced maybe sometime soon. But is there a role for the central bank to encourage, let's say, the private debt market rather than to see the accumulation of public debt rising to new heights, as Tuomas has mentioned?
A lot of points. I mean, I don't want to be against directing this debate, but there are many points which are being made. I mean, I'd like to react on this. Yeah. It is clear that we need more equity finance in general, and we have to facilitate that. It's part of increasing buffers somewhere in the economy. So you can have a fiscal, if your fiscal position is okay, then of course you have a capacity via the automatic stabilizers to absorb the shocks, which was not the case when we started the crisis. That was one of the problems. The other is private sector buffers. And among the buffers, you have indeed more equity-based rather than debt finance. My main point on debt finance is that you need, as was said rightly by our US colleague, what you really need if you have debt finance is mechanisms to deal with stress, when you have stress. And you need, and that we didn't have that. And moreover, in this monetary union, a lot of this money was funded, the deficit savings was funded by other countries. So you have a national dimension. As you know, there is no fiscal solidarity in the union. So my main point here is that we had a number of amplification mechanisms, weak equity markets, weak fiscal position in the beginning, very weak institutions in a number of countries, and that was when we created the euro. There was, I think this is recognized, we cannot deny that, there was a weak institutional setting because nobody thought about the financial crisis, a banking crisis in particular. So this is what, in the crisis, we are building. And we have to recognize it was a mistake that we didn't put that in the beginning. And we know the historical conditions when the euro was put in place. We know why, you know, that's history now. But now that we have recognized the problem, we are putting, as you know, we have taken the SSM, the supervision, and it goes on. The number of countries have reforms in terms of solvency law and all that. Let me, Niels, say one thing about all this discussion. It is, I don't deny, of course, the points. So, as GDP, as you said before, Ilmar, it goes from 66 to 92% of GDP, public debt. But if you see this increase of public debt, there is an issue with the denominator, because what I say, no growth, recessions. So that's one of the points. And then there is the other problem on the numerator, because you see also that there was a lot of substitute from private debt to public debt via the bailout of the banks, of course, because we didn't have a mechanism. So we have to look in granular terms, not in big figures and all that, say the public debt. We know that the public debt increased very much also because the banking sector had to be bailed out in a number of cases and because there was no mechanism of bail-in at that time. So, the very worrisome thing, which worries me the most in all this, if you take the real GDP 100, in 2008 Q1, first quarter, and you see GDP now for the area, now is 99.2 in real terms for the area. So that means more than 7 years, it will take 8 years to go back to the level we had in Q1 2008. 8 years. There is a lot of damage which is being done in our societies because of that, because you have this vicious circle. The longer the recession, the longer the gloom, the longer the gloom. Because, of course, you have issues of hysteresis, people are out of the labor market and all that. So the point we make on why we do take our mandate so strongly is that you have two issues on the inflation story for us. Well, I'll give you the figures first. If you look at the HICP, just the headline inflation, it goes from 100 to 111 in the period. That gives you 1.5, 1.57% per year. So we have declared close to 2% in the medium term. So people say, you should be patient, it will come. But I tell you that this is a long period of 7 years, where more than 7 years, where you undershoot your objective. So at some point, and I can give you the core inflation. Core goes from 100, excluding food and energy, from 100 to 110. That gives you 1.2% per year for the core, on average over this 7 point, almost 8 years. The problem with that is that it starts, you cannot escape as a central banker the issue that your inflation expectation starts, your longer-term expectations start to be influenced by this long period of low inflation. It's not because we really have a sort of mantra, we need to be close to 2% per se, but we just say that the systematic repetition of undershooting of an objective, however you measured it, over time, start to erode, you know, your longer-term expectations. So they may shift from 2 to 1, for example. The other problem is what we call the Phillips curve part, is that you have a lot of output gap, a lot of slack. We don't know exactly how much on the labor market. There's a lot of slack, which also erodes, you see, your more shorter-term dynamic on the inflation. So when we say, why don't you reach your objective? Yes, it's difficult to do, and we know a number of reasons I can explain that. Mm-hmm. But what I say that you have this mandate to reach that, and it's true that the credibility of the policy, and that I think Mario Draghi was saying that very clearly in Malta, the credibility of your policy, you cannot take it lightly. Even these instruments that you mentioned that many of you criticize, the toolbox, you have a duty. You have a duty to use the instruments you are paid for that, and you have a duty. So that's the point I'm making. Yeah. Of course, there are unintended consequences, and we are aware. When you say it's wealth distribution, QE is wealth distribution, there are wealth effects. It's not an instrument of wealth distribution, that's clear. But it has wealth effect. But think about the counterfactual. The biggest effect would be to fall back in recessions. And so, of course, that's debated. We know that the policy we have has significant impact on the supply, the credit conditions, and the financial conditions in general.
So, Ivan, do you agree that the counterfactual situation would have been really so terrifying that this alone would have been a reason to embark on non-standard measures? And when you have replied to that, I would like to come back to Ilmas also.
Yeah, I just wanted to speak about this because I wanted to clarify something because Peter understood my intervention as criticism of the ECB. I think in the current situation, the ECB policy was understandable. And I didn't criticize, even if it was launched, I was asked many times what I think about this, I didn't criticize it. The question is, question is why we are in the current situation and how to get out from this situation. And the relevant part of this question has to be also, what are the real results of the QE and why? Which means it's not criticism of the ECB, it's criticism of the politicians because lack of leadership, because lack of necessary reforms. But we have to say very openly, the power of ECB is huge. Last time I was finance minister between 2010 and 2012, which means during the crisis, Greece crisis, I spent nights in the Eurogroup meetings pushing for Greece to do reforms with very weak result. Then it was one speech of Mario Draghi in summer 2012 when he said ECB will do everything necessary for stabilizing situation. A situation was stabilized, which means power of ECB, Fed, is at the current situation tremendous. Of course, question again is why the situation is such as it is and if it is good. And let me just say that the problem was, because we heard that in the U.S. there are no bailouts for the states, and there is default of the states. One of the problems is that the same rule was also in the Lisbon Treaty, no bailout. Despite of this, it was bailout of Greece, and then everything what we know. And this, of course, also growing of moral hazard. And no real pressure for necessary structural reforms. And if we are here now in Riga, I will tell you just example how different was
the microphone working.
How different was economic? Maybe it's possible. Hear me, yeah. How different was economic development in three Baltic countries, Slovakia and Poland, in comparison to Hungary and Slovenia during 2000-2012? 13 years. During these 13 years, convergence progress. Convergence progress means how quickly we are approaching EU 15, Western European level on GDP per capita. Convergence progress in these five countries, most successful countries, in average was 21.4%. In every one from these five countries, it was more than 20%. At the same time, in Hungary, it was 5%. In Slovenia, it was 3%. What is the main reason of this? The main
reason is that Baltic countries, Poland and Slovakia, did real, deep, comprehensive reforms. And now, and this is important, based on the strength of economic freedom. The rate of redistribution in these countries were significantly decreased. While Slovakia in 2000 had public expenditures to GDP 52%, in 2008 we had 35%, from 52 to 35. On the contrary, Slovenia and Hungary didn't do this kind of reform and still have too high public expenditures to GDP, too high redistribution, so on and so on. And finally, let me answer my answer, why quantitative easing didn't bring results in increasing inflation. Why we have deflation? Because no trust. Because no trust. And money are about trust. And finally, people, ordinary people, are more clever than theoreticians who thought it will work, it have to work. Why it doesn't work? Because people know that what Ilmar said, that it means further higher taxes. Even companies know that this is not about price of money, this is about future growth. If there will be no future growth, they will not invest, they will not take new loans. And then you are in the vicious cycle. Which means this is not criticism of the ECB. ECB is doing what is possible, what is necessary to do to fulfill their mandate, but at the same time, it is softening necessary pressure for real changes. That's the point.
So there is a certain degree of consensus building here, and that's nice, but we still want to have controversial exchanges. And Ilmas, I'm not sure whether you wanted to address the inequality or the redistribution effects or whether there was another point, but I'm sure you will like to reply to what has been said here. And then I think I will also try to open up the floor for questions from the audience.
Ilmas. Yes, one additional remark. Peter was mentioning the numbers about GDP today vis-a-vis GDP 2008. We've looked at these things, and Latvia is one of the few countries which has recovered together with Estonia, Lithuania, and we have reached the pre-crisis level. And we know all the statistics, and we could go on and on and on. But the question is, what to do? And bringing my medicine discussion from the morning speech, I don't know, maybe aspirin is not strong enough. Let's use antibiotics. The question is now, what Ivan was mentioning and referring, that by having more aspirin, by having more antibiotics, basically having the side effects of the body. And that's what is important, yes? We doing our job, that, no doubt about that, and it's very difficult to criticize the ECB. I mean, ECB is doing whatever it takes, no doubt about it. But too much money, unnecessary money in the system, it makes the pension funds, the insurance companies, looking for very risky assets. We don't know what's going to happen with these investments in years to come. Maybe they will lose money. Not even mentioning what will happen if, what you asked at the beginning, if we will touch the interest rates. What will happen with their book? So these are the questions, how long this could go. And therefore, one of the recipes when Latvia was overcoming the crisis was speed. And that's what we was advising to our Greek colleagues. And people said, okay, are you, governor, willing to subscribe the same recipe now for Greece? Absolutely not. because they have wasted 5-6 years, very crucial years, where is the fatigue of consolidation. You cannot ask the people to do what Latvia did it in the first year. So the same thing now is for the Europe. Yeah? We're basically losing the time. We don't have this discussion. We're just printing the money. Hopefully something will happen. No.
So I guess it's one of the intended effects of QE is to push, indeed, the investors out to more risky investments, because more risky investments can also be something that produces more productivity. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But let me just you'll get the floor in a moment, Peter,
sure,
but let me just pick up on one thing that Ivan said in the beginning, namely the competitive devaluation thing, let's say the effect of QE to be an international phenomenon that pushes down your own exchange rate and then forces others to do more of the same. Thomas, is that something, because you go to all these international meetings, is that something that you can recognize this effect and that there is a competitive devaluation element of it?
Well, yes, it is, of course. Although these international meetings, people tend to be very guarded about what they say about these things. But the emerging economies tend to complain about the effects of QE. Brazil used to be one that the most vocal about this. Now things have turned in Brazil, and they are actually quite happy about the loose monetary policy in the United States. But generally, I would think, given that this very low level of inflation is something that most of the developed world is struggling with, this competitive QE is not really a bad thing, because it sort of, in the end, it ensures that the monetary stimulus is global, a global response to a global issue. So I don't consider it a problem in itself.
Peter, you wanted to take the floor to react on some of the things, but I would also like to hear about what kind of thoughts the ECB has made to regarding the exit strategy that will at some point be relevant. So we are piling up debt. Some of the debt ends up on the central bank's balance sheet. How can we, it was also something that was addressed by several of the speakers, how can we get out of this in the end when there is a need to get out of it?
No, I have no issue with that. You raised before, different points. Let's be very clear. When and Ilmar, you alluded to that when you said there is a huge injection of liquidity. I just wanted to remind us that we talk about base money, central bank money. It's true. If you look at money supply, right? Money supply, that means government money, central bank money, and commercial bank money. Money growth has been weak. Has been weak because of the balance sheet adjustment, because of the troubles of banks, and is recovering in the euro area. Is just below 5% on year basis, but is not shooting up. It is just a substitution between a contraction of private bank money, because people were getting out in several countries of private money, and they went into government money, central bank money, and we supplied that, and that was a substitution. Now, of course, by trying with base money, what you want is to stimulate reserves of the bank, liquidity, as you say rightly, so they get that. What do they do on the asset side? You're right, it's not fantastic. But what you have seen recently is a turnover in the credit dynamics also for the non-financial corporations. But as you say rightly, it remains weak. And the key issue, and I think we agree on that, is how do you deal with the legacy assets? Because I found your points were pretty good. We deal with misallocation of resources, can be from the government side or the private sector side. How do you deal with the legacy asset, the stock there? And of course, when you provide cheap funding to carry these bad assets, of course, there is always the risk that you had in Japan of creating zombie banks, because it's cheap to muddle through, hope, that better times are going to come. And I fully agree, for me, one of the key issues that remains here, and which I think as a central banker is something that always worries me, is the fact that you have in a number of countries non-performing loans still weighing very much on the asset side of the banks. Mm. And this is too timidly being addressed. It is being addressed, but we know the figures. We know the proportions in the balance sheet. And so this is a reflection that also we have as supervisor in the ECB, but you also know that a number of countries, including Italy, are trying to address this by developing their institutions, institutions that have been, as I said, very weak. Now, it takes time, and this is indeed the problem that you, Ilmar, say, is that given this weakness of institutions to address these legacy problems, your monetary policy is, you know, forced, I would say, to continue longer than what it would be needed if these problems would be tackled from the beginning. Of course, we know that. So we watch that very carefully. So that on flooding the market with liquidity, well, money supply is weak in general and was almost contracting at some points, and in some countries was really falling, money supply was falling. So you inject central bank money. As you say, there is a demand. You say there is a demand for safe asset because in crisis people, why do you think people buy at negative rates? Because they want safe asset, they're ready to pay a price for that. This is a big issue. So because of this anxiety, this need to buy a safe asset and the shortage of that, you provide money. And on the other hand, well, you try to stimulate, by the way, risk appetite, because risk appetite is too small. Now, of course, I fully agree with your points that there are unintended consequences, because when you stimulate risk appetite, markets may decide to go in some places of the world when they think, you know, that they have a good story. So they may go in the emerging markets, you know, a couple of years ago by saying, you know, I want to take risk because, you know, I don't know what to do with my money. And then they jump in some markets, you create some asset price inflation in these countries, et cetera, et cetera. We are very well aware of that. But it's, as we always say, and we have these very rich discussions in the Governing Council, and I always say high quality, there are different views. But the analysis is always very rich and respectful. I fully respect all the views. But it's a balancing act because you always have to say, what do you do? Should you go further with the risk that you mentioned, which are real? I fully accept that. And what is the risk of not doing that at the same time? And the Governing Council is always, as you know, able, not only willing, but also able to act. We always have demonstrated this capacity to act collectively, which is, as you rightly say, we wouldn't say that for the politicians in general at the community level. That was your point, and take it. The message, you mentioned the whatever it takes of Mario, but I also mentioned, you should mention also the Jackson Hole speech in 14, in the summer of 14, where we thought, as you also said, the sort of financial crisis, acute financial crisis period, which was a context of 2012. In 2014, the context was more the weak growth, the lack of structural reforms, and all that. So the message was, we need a comprehensive policy response, We do our part because we have that mandate, and we can justify and defend it. But the other politicians, the other parts have to do their parts. If in the end they don't do it, they will bear the responsibility. Yeah. Now, I'm not that negative. A number of reforms are there, but a lot of time has been wasted. It's a long period of no growth on average. And that leaves, we have scars, and that means that the reforms must even be stronger than what they would have been.
Great to have this insight from the Governing Council and some flavor of the discussion there. That's really very useful. I would like to just take a look out in the audience and see if there are people who would like to ask a question. There is a gentleman in one of the last rows. Could you please pass the microphone to this gentleman? Will you ask in English or in Latvian? Okay. So let's hear what
is
on your mind.
My name is Juris Kaja. I'm a stringer for the Wall Street Journal here in Latvia. And my question is both to Mr. Pratt and also to Ilmar Simsevits, or two questions. It is assumed that it is inevitable that the asset buying program of the ECB will continue. There have been hints that it will be broadened in the sense that more money will be spent. Is it not likely that if more money is spent, there will be new classes of assets that will be purchased because the assets that we have been buying, or the bank has been buying so far, are sort of close to exhaustion in some places? That is to Peter Pratt. To Ilmar Simsevits, you said that one of the problems that is keeping liquidity bottled up in the banking system is the fact that tax policies are uncertain. Is that applicable only to Latvia, where we have two national hobbies, playing hockey and changing taxes, or is that or is that something that is more broader in Europe, and that politicians should set forth clear roadmaps on where tax policy is going so that lenders then could be more secure in lending?
Thank you very much. Peter, do you want to take care of the first question then, about the asset classes possibly to be widened?
No, I mean, the story is relatively simple. Downside risk have clearly increased recently. That has to do with the global environment. In particular, the risk of, again, pushing back, the moment of realization of your objective. As I said before, we had in this picture I described about inflation in this 7 to 8 years period, it's a little bit a déjà vu. That means a situation we have been confronted already, pushing always back, in the future, the realization, the day where we get close to 2%. So with the context I just described, with downside risk increasing, some relatively mild for the time being downwards revision of real GDP growth rate, we have this increasing risk of pushing back again, the moment where we reach close to 2%. So this means that, again, as we always have demonstrated, when we make that sort of assessment, it's a risk assessment for the time being, we take it very seriously, and then we say the occasion of December. December is the meeting of the Governing Council where we have a comprehensive review of the economic conditions, all the central banks, by the way. It's not only the ECB staff, but it's all your system staff working together at the national level. We consolidate. We have also models looking at the behavior of the euro area as a whole. So we do it country by country, but also for the region as a whole. And that will be the basis of the discussion of the Governing Council about, the perspective of going back to a sustainable path of inflation close to 2%, which we announced when we came with the asset purchase program, because we fixed September as one of the 16 as one of the milestones. So that will be one of the discussions, key discussions in the Governing Council of December.
But the question was about asset classes.
No, I know the question. I heard the question. The second point, no, Neil. Well, he used to work at the ECB, so we know each other. But no, the second point we said very clearly is that we need, we will re-examine the toolbox, the efficiency of the toolbox, as some of you mentioned. So we will have a review of this. And I said personally that because I have the economics department and the monetary policy, people working on monetary policy, they work well. And I tell them, you work without taboo, so you examine the toolbox again, and you look at the efficiency and of all the different instruments that are available for a central bank. I will not say more than that, because when I say you can work at 360 degree, now the Governing Council, in its wisdom, will look at this. So I don't want to put constraints on the staff. Looking at experience, don't forget, when you deal in a situation at the beginning of the crisis, because you ask in the beginning, what would you do if you were in the position of a central bank? But think about, I could inform you what was the position of the central bank. The position is that at some point you think you need demand management, first debate. You need structural reforms, but you're also in a balance sheet recession, you really need to support demand. Fiscal policy is complicated because they're part of the problem. So the burden in terms of policy mix falls on monetary policy. And then you start with the monetary policy with the nominal rates for some reasons, secular reasons that you explain. The nominal rates are quite low at the beginning. So you lit a lower bound. We don't know exactly what is this lower bound because this is untested in history. So you test this lower bound limit. And then you think about what are the other tools. When you were around in our community, we had discussions about guidance. Can you commit yourself on future policy? And we did it in July, when was it? 14, I think, we committed to say, this is the assessment of the situation, and this is the path of monetary policy that we expect, so low rates for a long time, given that assessment. So we communicated that. But later on, we had this lower bound tested below 0%. We also tested the interventions in the market and interventions to stimulate credit. And I think the results are not bad, frankly, because I know what would, well, I think I know what would be the alternative to that. And then on the lower bound, because that's one of the questions there, I always said, as with all non-standard measures, because there is almost nothing in the textbooks, monetary policy textbook in universities. You look at the experiences of central banks all over the world. We looked at Japan, we look at the US, we look at the UK, we also look at our own experience, we look at Sweden, we look at Denmark, we look at Switzerland. So we build on experience, our own experience, and the experience of others in the non-standard measures. And that's the exercise which is being done now.
So there are lots of experiences also with forward guidance, and some central banks have mixed experience, to say the least. I mean, later today we will have the news from the Federal Reserve, which has time and again postponed. You're not the Federal Reserve, and I don't ask you to comment on that, but just to remind us that there are central banks with different experiences. But there was a question for you also, Imaš. Would you like to take up that?
Yes,
that
I would like to remind the participants that in the previous panel there was, I think, brilliant discussion about different levels of debt for the probably different countries. And for the big countries, there has been research, maybe 90% would be sustainable debt level, for the medium countries 60, for smaller maybe 40. And coming to the national sport, yes, hockey, and then I think mushrooming, and only then tax changes. And tax changes, well, what I'm trying to say is, remember, 40, 60, 90. So, and in all countries, it's not only in Latvia, but business is observing. So, of course, the higher the debt level, so it's even more dramatic. If you have a debt level of 130%, it's almost easy betting that there's no other choice but to raise the taxes, because somehow politicians have avoided to cut expenditures. So, therefore, it works across the board.
There was a question on inequality also from the tweets that are coming in, but Thomas, you want to reply directly on this, or?
Yeah, I just wanted to respond because, I mean, these two gentlemen here are members of the Governing Council, and that means that they cannot say anything interesting in response to questions about monetary policy. But since I'm not involved with monetary policy making anymore, I can voice opinions as much as I want. Already at the time when I was a central banker, I was of the opinion that we should actively look into other asset classes. I was never a great fan of buying government bonds for the legal gray zone issues. But, I mean, private papers, not only would they be legally less problematic, they would also be more direct in terms of having a monetary policy effect. I mean, basically when we buy, or you buy, sorry, still a central banker in heart, when you buy long-dated government assets, the only thing that happens is, in the eyes of the private sector, they are converted from long-dated to overnight assets. The private sector still ends up holding public assets, but in the form of central bank deposits rather than government bonds. So, you can see that this is not something that you get a whole lot of mileage from. But if you instead start dealing with securitized private sector assets, or, lo and behold, equity, the effects on the real economy would be in a different class. I'm not saying that it would be unproblematic, but there is something to be thought about there.
He's thinking 360 degrees.
Ivan, would it be interesting to hear, would you be less skeptical towards QE if it would involve the purchasing of more private assets as it's being proposed now?
I don't think that it could be decisive change in this regard. Because the most important question is what to do and how to do it to speeding up necessary structural reforms.
Yeah.
This is the key point. And in this regard, what I think is missing the most is leadership, and ownership of reforms. And leadership is key in this regard. I like another quotation, which is, I think, very nice in this regard. The quotation, what is the difference between politician and statesman? Why politician cares about next election, statesman cares about next generations. And this short-term approach, which is focused only on the election results, is one of the most important obstacle for doing really necessary reforms. And we are missing, we're missing the leadership. We're missing ownership. And in this regard, it is very, very good example, and this is pity, that not so many people know your story, Latvian story. Because your story in 2008-2009 was clear evidence that it can work. Because you didn't have formally euro, but in reality, practically, you had euro because you had fixed rate, and you sustained this rate by doing reforms, by doing internal devaluation and really hard fiscal consolidation and structural reforms. And it worked. It was difficult, of course. It was hardship, but it worked. Which means this is the point. This is not a technical question about what is the share of the private equities and deep, bonds. It is about, finally, about the reforms. And finally, it is about politics. This is, and if you look at any problem, if you look at immigration problem now in structural reforms, this is lack of leadership, which is the biggest problem for the necessary change and for the solving the real solution, not only. Because reforms, from 90-95% reforms are not technical problem, they are political problem. There are a lot of experiences from countries like Latvia and others, of course, Sweden, which are showing what works, what doesn't work. The problem is that there is no will to do it.
So there was a big compliment for Latvia here, and we also have some additional questions. If I may take the lady in the middle first, and then I come back to you.
Thank you. Hello, I'm Lasma Kuhtarsk, and I wanted to ask about interest rates you mentioned at the beginning. So Federal Reserves haven't increased them since 2006, and now they have been planning to increase them. What would be the effect of that? And is it really a way out of this situation?
Oh, that's a difficult one. Anyone wants to take the floor on that?
I didn't understand.
So what's the...
Can you rephrase a little bit?
Can you maybe repeat the question in a different way?
What happens if the Fed increase the interest rate?
The Federal Reserve.
Yeah, Federal Reserves haven't increased them since 2006, and now they have been planning to increase them, interest rates. So what would be the effect, and is it a way out also for maybe other countries or for Federal Reserves?
So once the Fed starts to raise interest rates, what kind of impact will it have on the policies in Europe? Anyone dares to take the floor on that? It's a very difficult one. Thomas?
Thomas.
I think Thomas, yeah. You will be the victim here.
Yeah.
But you're in the public sector.
Well, yes. I mean, I must say that I don't understand really the debate about whether the Fed raises rates this time or the next time or in 3 months' time. What does it matter? We know they are probably the rates are going to rise. To what extent it affects us in Europe, I don't think much. Because, I mean, anything that the Fed is going to do is so much in the expectations already that they should be reflected in the prices. By the way, just an anecdote. I mean, if I'm right, I don't think there is a single person in the FOMC that has ever raised interest rates. So this must be a huge psychological hurdle for them.
Yeah, interesting.
Can I make a technical, not interesting observation to follow your qualification. In general, I mean, it's not to do with the Fed, but when you move a rate, it's always a signal, of course, but what matters is not that rate. It's the expectation about the path of the rates, you know, and that's more important. It's not per se, you know, this move of a rate per se, but what will be the communication about the expected path? I mean, and that's usually what why markets are looking so much. I mean, it's what is the sequence, you see, and not only one, the day when you move a rate. So it's the sequence and the expectations around that. So I wanted also to say that we look at all information available. So we look at, of course, China, for example, is also moving interest rates. You didn't mention China. So we look a little bit at our environment, and what we know is that our monetary policy stance is at a different place in the cycle than the US, of course. That's obvious. We have communicated that already before.
Yeah. So China is going the other way, and maybe
China is in the accommodating
in a
phase.
Loosening mode, yeah. We are approaching the end of this session, but I'd like to give Kenichi the floor also to ask a question to this panel here.
Sorry, I should be actually shut my mouse because I the panel is. Anyway, I just want to actually more comments on asset class issues that central bank can buy or should buy, because you know we have a huge discussion because BOJ is buying stocks and real estate related instruments, private sector issued instruments, and the problem. I do think that's a problem because essentially, of course. BOJ buying a basket of ETF, but it's a reality. It still might be some temptation to buy, for example, ECB might be a possibility to buy Volkswagen stocks, for example, or the buying real estate in Athens. Like that kind of targeted purchase might become a problem. Even it's a Nikkei average Tokyo Stock Exchange basket. Still, listed company is a relatively big companies in any countries, as in Europe and Japan. So we could say that's still biased towards big companies in terms of kind of subsidy. That's always there. So the question, why the central bank anyway should be involving a kind of more direct kind of subsidy to funding costs? Of private sector companies or real estate price. I think it's always a question. I mean, if anyway government want to do kind of that kind of system, it's better to do through a development bank in a fiscal money rather than a central bank money.
So the question
that's,
is
that's my
whether sense. whether this is an avenue for the ECB to again learn a little bit from Japan. Maybe the two central bankers can answer this, and then we will have to wrap it up.
But you didn't mention what is in the balance sheet of the central bank, what is the proportion, what is the volume of ETFs, let's say equities that they have. You know the figure?
So then
you start, you know, seeing what is the impact and what is the purpose, what is the impact of having a small intervention of the central bank in the equity markets via ETFs. I mean, and that's is interesting. You could have explained that. What is the purpose really of buying a small piece? You know, there. I don't want to say more than that, but I think it's an interesting discussion.
Ilmas, would you would have the opportunity to now to take the floor as the last speaker, if you want to say something about this. Possibility of going down that avenue that has been tried in Japan. Would you be willing to look at that?
Well, like Peter said, toolbox is huge. There are a lot of instruments. You could do everything. Whether that would make any difference, that's the question. So just going further, deeper, more asset classes, more instruments, more private debt, and so on. Whether something happens in between. So therefore, I think we would be very, very careful exhausting all the instruments immediately just before seeing how the initial package is working.
Yeah? Okay, so I want to say thank you to all the four panelists for a very lively discussion. Also thanks to the audience for both listening and contributing to the questions. That was really a very nice occasion to discuss on a broad level the issues of how growth and debt are correlated. And with this, I think we have deserved something else that Joris will tell us about.
First, thank you for a good discussion.